I'm back in Yucatan. I was in some other parts of Mexico for a little bit, and I've landed back here. And then this weekend I'll be going to San Luis to visit some family, and then I'll be going to Colorado for a little more than a week, and then I'll be back here
All right.
till June. Yep.
How exciting. Well, our guest today, as I mentioned when I played her music at the outset, that's how I was introduced to her, was through that particular song. And I was so intrigued that I started looking her up and was captivated by her story, where I found resonance, and I think a lot of people will today. We're all on a path towards humanity and enlightenment, and so Stacy is us, and we are her. She is a Christian music artist, a speaker, an author, who turned her love for music and words into a full-time vocation. She formed her own publishing company and record label and landed multiple film and television placements. Her latest book, Love Makes Room, is a memoir about how her faith and heart expanded after her teenage daughter came out as gay. Stacy and her husband make their home in the Bay Area. So she's a fellow Californian, even though there's some here who are not Californians. But take it away, Stacy. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you. It's good to be here. Thank you so much. Yeah, it's the kind of that latter part of the story that I want to talk about a little bit today. I want to share a story, a part of my story that feels a little bit like maybe like the Advent season we find ourselves in. It's a story about making room for a God who showed up unexpectedly and in a way that I thought was scandalous at the time, a way that caused my heart to break and then open up and let in more love and more grace and most importantly, people that I had considered somehow outside God's circle of inclusion. Imagine, this is kind of the best way I know how to explain it. Imagine living in a house your whole life that's where everything is familiar to you, where everything's always where it's been, know where you can find it, organized, tidy, predictable. And then one day a package shows up at your door from someone you love dearly. Something so unexpected and mysterious and large that you have nowhere to put it in this tiny house of yours. And you're faced with the choice of either completely rearranging everything in the house to make room for this huge package, or turning it away at the door. In my case, the package that arrived was my own daughter coming out as gay, and the house it didn't fit into was the conservative Christian belief system that I had grown up with and was living in at the time. It seemed an impossible choice. The narrow house I lived in was shaped by my upbringing. I was raised conservative evangelical. I came to know Jesus in a personal way at an Assemblies of God church when I was 12 years old. I went on to attend a Christian high school, attend Christian Bible college. My whole worldview was shaped by the understanding that scripture, that the Bible, contained everything we would ever need for life. It was a literal, inerrant manual, for everything we needed to know in life. And as such, homosexuality, as I understood it, was sin. It was a way in which people had separated themselves from the love of God. It was outside of my scope of understanding that that my child could then be gay. My social exposure, because I grew up in a Christian home, even though I was in the San Francisco Bay Area, which David pointed out, is kind of an interesting reality that you know, even in one of the most, you know, areas where the LGBTQ community is thriving most in the San Francisco Bay Area, I managed to stay in this tiny, narrow belief system, very sheltered, did not have many gay friends at all. And, you know, my understanding of anyone who was gay was what I had seen on television or read in a book. I did not have much encounter with the community. And on top of all that, as an adult, I made my living speaking and singing, leading worship in evangelical Christian spaces that were very much like when I come up through. I raised my kids. They were baptized in an Assembly of God church. I married a man who's was from the Latin Assembly of God denomination. His parents were both preachers in that denomination. And so really my, how I saw my child's future was like all the other Christian moms I knew. I wanted my daughter to grow up and meet a good man and get married and have babies and give me grandchildren and really live a life that I thought was blessed as I understood it to be. So into that world came a day when my daughter was 16, which is now 10 years ago. So I'm revisiting events as I share this story from 10 years ago. So at 16 years old, we get in the car. I'm taking Abby is my daughter's name. I take her to school and she's crying inconsolably. And no matter how many questions I'm asking her about what's wrong, she's not telling me and she's not letting up on the sobs. We get near to the school and I realize I can't drop my child off at school in this condition. So I pull over, stop the car. It's pouring down rain. And I say, honey, you have to tell me what's wrong. I can't take you to school like this. I don't know how to help you unless you tell me what's wrong. And she said, well, for starters, if I tell you what's wrong, I have to tell you everything. And I remember hearing those words and just fear gripping my heart because, you know, those are not the words the mom of a teenage daughter wants to hear as her daughter's crying inconsolably on the way to school. I mean, what does it mean? I have to tell you everything. You know, immediately my mind went to all these scenarios in my head and I began questioning her about them. I said, has someone been bullying you? Has someone touched you inappropriately? And then, of course, the mother of all questions, which I thought, you know, I was trembling in my boots to say was, are you pregnant? All of which she was saying no to, shaking her head no, still crying. And then she said, kind of blurted out, my heart is broken. And I thought, well, then this is it. My daughter's had her heart broken. She's broken up with a boy. I mean, I had no clue. I had absolutely no clue. I was searching in the dark. And finally, she said, it wasn't a boy that broke my heart. And I said, are you telling me you're gay? And she said, she nodded and then more crying. And I can remember sitting in that car and just feeling this kind of cold fog of dread falling into my bones because I had nowhere to put this information. I knew where to put an unwanted pregnancy. I knew where to put bullying. I knew where to put sexual abuse. I knew where to put trouble in school. I had files for all of that. I had systems in place that I could tap into to help her in those areas. I had no clue where to put this information that my daughter was gay. You know, the only way I understood it was through the social and religious framework that I'd come up through, and it just did not fit anywhere. At the same time, this was my daughter. And so I knew there was no way I was turning this package away. There was no way I was not going to accept or understand this. And so I had to make room where there was no room in my understanding. I think one of the first things I had to make room for was this barrage of questions that was kind of raining down on me. I can remember that one of the first places I went to was cause, you know, what causes a child to be gay? And at the time I didn't know. I the first place I went was inward. I thought I did something wrong. I had failed her as a mother. We had failed her as parents. Something happened somewhere in her formative years that I broke somehow. And one thought led to another. I went down Google rabbit trails. I tried to understand something about what might have caused this, and that led then to the deeper questions, which were more along the lines of, what will become of my child's eternal soul? How does God see this? How do I reconcile this with what I've been taught all my life? What will happen to her future? Who will take care of her? What about her job situation? What about, how do we tell our church friends? The questions just didn't stop. And I have to tell you that in those early weeks and even months, the answers didn't come. It was just sort of a great unknowing. It was a settling into sort of a free fall of, I don't know, I don't know, and I don't know. And it was then I think I was first, my heart was first cracking open to stretch into this understanding that sometimes people of faith have to make room for uncertainty. And that was not a reality in my other world. I mean, we lived to be certain of what we believed. You know, we had Bible verses for everything. And this had no Bible verse. I didn't find assurances in the Bible nor in any of the teachings that I had come up with. But I had a teenager to raise. I mean, as far as I knew, this kid wasn't going to raise herself, and I had to be a mom. And so I, you know, sort of had to put on my big girl pants and say, well, what does a mom do in this situation to raise a socially conscious, good kid? And I remember that at that point, I had to make room for awkward conversations with my daughter. There were times when, for instance, I didn't know if sleepovers were still going to be an appropriate thing. My daughter was very social, had lots of friends. And in the past, she'd always had sleepovers and gone places with both boys and girls and had lots of friends. But suddenly in this new world, I didn't know if I was being a good mom if I let a girl who was a friend sleep over. I didn't know if that was maybe being not a discerning mom. And I had to have awkward conversations with my daughter about, what does it mean to have friends that you're not attracted to? What does it look like to be attracted to some of your girlfriends? Please help me understand which of these friends you're attracted to. And I want to try and be your mom, but also I'm here to help lay some ground rules. And, you know, I can remember her kind of rolling her eyes at these Q&As and saying, oh, mom, you're so lame, you know? And I was being lame, but I was trying to understand her world and also understand my role in it still as her mother. But I can remember her saying, you're going to have to trust me. And, I did. I was going to have to trust her, and I would. And I was also watching in these teenage years, in the early months before, after she'd come out, I watched a friendship of hers develop into a crush, and then develop into something deeper. And this was a girl who had been a best friend of my daughter's for a long time. And as I watched the relationship progress into something different than just BFFs, it was kind of a revelation to me that I would ask Abby, what does it feel like? What's different? How are your feelings different now? And I had to listen with an open heart as my daughter explained how it felt to fall in love. And of course, what I realized in those months as I watched my daughter fall in love was that I was confused about where the sin part was, right? That I'd been raised with this concept that same-sex attraction, same-sex couples, that it was sinful. And as I watched my daughter fall in love in the most natural way that it happened for me with my husband, I thought, well, there's nothing sinful here. It's actually just Abby being Abby and loving who Abby is loving. That was a big part of the understanding for me, and seeing her as a whole human and not someone who's somehow broken or needed fixing or disordered. And as I was coming to this understanding that loving Abby unconditionally meant seeing her as a person made in the image of God, and not as some kind of mistake that God made, and not as some kind of, you know, person who's willfully deciding to sin or disobey, as I was making room for that understanding of her, my conversations with my Christian friends became difficult and strained, if you can imagine. You know, most Christian communities that I ran in and that I was a part of and that I sang in and spoke in, they weren't having conversations about this topic beyond a very simplistic surface level of sin and not sin. You know, no one I knew had a child they were raising who was out and gay. So learning who was safe to talk to about this and, you know, who would end the conversation with a comment like, well, I'll be praying for her, or, you know, we can't condone the sin. Those kinds of conversations got very awkward and difficult for me. And I realized that many of my so-called friends believed that my daughter needed fixing, and that when they said we'll be praying for her, they meant praying for her to change, praying for her to be straight, praying for her to see the error of her ways and turn around and repent. And that's not at all how I was seeing the situation unfold in my own home. And so I came to these kind of crossroads in my relationships with my community, you know, where I realized I could no longer align myself with the way they would pray for my child. And as I sat next to a pews with friends who I knew for a fact did not want my child to flourish in the same ways they wanted their child to, it became kind of a deal breaker. You know, that something shifted and really separated in my heart from those places and those spaces of worship, as well as those friendships. You know, I wasn't going to be worshiping alongside people who wanted to pray the gay away. I didn't think that was possible anymore. And at the same time, I was also seeing that this area where I made my living, which was leading worship and singing at women's conferences and teaching on creativity and music, I was seeing those platforms, those doors were closing, you know, as I was exploring more of this experience I was having with my daughter being gay, as I was being a little bit more vocal about that slowly but surely, doors were closing in my career life, in my vocational life, because, you know, the gatekeepers, pastors and music pastors and women's ministry leaders were not comfortable with where my heart was landing on this topic. And so I got more than one phone call of uninvitation, I call it, where someone would say, you know, we have you booked for this conference, but we need to pull back on our invite because we're just not okay with where you're landing on this topic of homosexuality. It was a painful, isolating season of my life, but at the same time, it, as those seasons do, right, they kind of push us forward into a new direction. And I began to seek out friendship and community online. To be honest with you, I began to look at authors and thought leaders who were kind of asking the same questions and walking the same path as I was. I began reading books by people who were way outside of my narrow denominational box. I read Matthew Vine's book, God and the Gay Christian. I read Justin Lee's book, Torn. I read a couple of biographies by Christian musicians, Jennifer Knapp and Vicky Beeching, who talked about coming out. And then I began reading theology books by people like Richard Rohr and Pete Enns and Sarah Bessie and Caitlin Curtis and Rachel Held Evans. And these were folks who were asking the same questions and moving forward on a path that I felt that I was moving on. And it was a stretching, it was a growing. I keep saying it wasn't one big aha moment, but it was these small little tributaries that were leading into a bigger, wider, more inclusive ocean. And, you know, as my community began expanding and as the people I trusted and could share with was expanding, I also, at the same time, I have to confess to you that I was woefully ignorant about the LGBTQ community. My daughter was, you know, as she got a little bit older, she was hanging out with her gay friends. And I grew up in a time, you know, in the 70s and 80s in the San Francisco Bay Area, but still in a pretty conservative circle where people were afraid of something that they called the gay agenda and the gay lifestyle. And I'd heard rumors about, you know, young people being brainwashed into this community. And I had all these very, very unrealistic, unfounded fears about what the LGBT community even was. And as my daughter was spending more time with them, I remember reading a wise person saying, you know, if you're trying to build a bridge between two places, you have to spend time on both sides of the places you're trying to connect. I had spent all my life in this evangelical Christian conservative space, but I had spent exactly zero time among the LGBTQ folks. And so I knew I had to start taking baby steps just to see for myself the kind of friends Abby was hanging out with, what they did, what did they do when they went out. I don't know exactly what I thought they were doing, but here's what I discovered. One night, my daughter asked me to come and hear her sing at an open mic night. She's a musician also. She was 19 and it was at a bar. And I said, well, sure, I'll come hear you sing. And then she kind of slipped in at the last minute. Also, it's a lesbian bar. And I was like, sure thing, you know, no problem. So I showed up and I'm quite sure that with my sensible clothing and my, you know, probably very uptight body language, I might as well have just been holding a banner that said, you know, hetero Christian mom coming through. Because I walked through to the table where my daughter's friends were sitting. I sat down with them and felt as awkward and as uncomfortable as I'd ever felt. Took a deep breath, had a sip of wine, and just started listening to her friends talking at this table while my daughter was singing on stage. And as I'm listening to them talk, you know, they're talking about parents, school, jobs, relationships. I realized, well, these are just like any other young people I'd be sitting at a table with. There's nobody who's being weird or out of place or inappropriate, or there's nothing that's perverted happening in this place. It was, I'm ashamed to say that I came with these really weird expectations and discovered instead that, you know, it was never a them and us situation. It was always us, you know, that I had more in common with these young women than I had any differences with. That was a big point of understanding for me. And it was, again, it was a tiny step, but it was a step that cracked my heart open. You know, I can remember around 2015 when the Supreme Court voted in favor of gay marriage. I remember at the time thinking that, you know, that I was so relieved with this decision on behalf of my daughter and just thinking about her and her friends. And yet when I went on Facebook, most of the people I knew in my circles and who I was following and in my newsfeed were up in arms about it and were leaving the most vitriolic and horrifically judgmental and condemning comments. Each of which I was feeling like a personal punch to the gut at that point, you know, and I decided I needed to probably be more vocal about where I landed on this topic. And I published a blog post in July of 2015 that was called What I Learned About Love When My Daughter Came Out. And it went as viral as anything I've ever written before. And in the weeks that followed, the Huffington Post religion section picked it up and ran it for a while. And I was inundated with messages, you know, private messages, texts, emails from so many Christian families, a lot of parents who were in ministry who said, I'm a pastor, my daughter came out and I can't talk about it or I'll be fired from my job. A lot of, you know, our daughter tried to kill herself last week because she was too afraid to tell us that she she had a girlfriend, you know, we're from a Christian church, we're pastors. Boom, 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 down the line. It was as though this door, the wardrobe to Narnia had opened, and I saw this world of, you know, parents and kids in pain, in conflict, in despair over this topic of not being able to be fully talking about this. I saw especially kids just in so much pain at having been rejected by their families. And, you know, I realized that there weren't a lot of people in my space, with my platform and this background I had, talking about this from a really, from the point of view that I was going to, wanted to talk about it. And in honor of their stories and in the belief that a story, even one small story, can help someone else share their story, I started writing this book called Love Makes Room. And had finished the book, I hadn't really fully come to full understanding of the theological ins and outs and questions and whys and hows of scripture. But I do know that that my heart was making room for a much more expansive faith at that point. That from Genesis to Revelation, you know, I was seeing a God creator who made us as and called us good, you know, that there wasn't this problem that was needing to be solved somehow between God and us, that we had always been good, and that this God pursued relationship with us, this God forgave and welcomed, this God healed and restored and included people from all walks of life, especially the margins. And I saw Jesus who described God's kingdom using words like a mansion with many rooms, an abundant life, you know, these metaphors of bigness, of generosity. And I realized that this God, you know, had to somehow be like my mother's heart that wanted my daughter and all LGBTQ people to flourish in ways that I thought had been impossible. I wanted my daughter to fall in love and to be loved back. I wanted her to have, to be able to use her gifts and her, whatever her calling was, to be able to follow into that calling, in any way that she saw fit. And I began to see a God whose love and whose grace were so big and so inclusive and so generous and spacious that, you know, my old belief system could not contain this love. I wrote the book, I released it in May of this year. And I have to tell you, you know, I'm still on a path of learning. Like David said, I'm still on this path toward becoming whole, toward becoming human. You know, I am still hoping to have awkward conversations with my daughter and with other LGBTQ people about what it means to be them. And I'm also very, very interested in engaging other Christians in this topic, Christians who are interested in having more compassionate, informed conversations about what it looks like to love our LGBTQ brothers and sisters. And I'm so very grateful for communities like this that have invited me to come and share. Because to be honest, I didn't even know places like this existed, you know. I didn't. And it has been such a joy to discover folks that are on a similar trajectory toward, I think, a more expansive, generous, inclusive love. And I absolutely believe with all my heart that's where God is. And so I'm grateful for the chance to share my story. Thank you, Dr. Moore. And thank you everybody for listening today.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stacy. I had to take myself off of video for a little bit because the tears came as someone who has recently come out to more people. To just hear you say it's not sinful, even though in my head I know it's not, just to hear somebody say it to me.
Right.
To all of us. So yeah, what did everyone think? For me, it was the openness to bigness of how big God is. What did you all think?
I'll jump in. I loved it. I love what you had to say. And I loved what you said about Anna, what you pulled out too. Like there's no sin here, having that moment of realization. Where is the sin?
Yeah.
I wish more people could have that moment of realization. But I loved your whole story. So thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
I saw a lot of heart emojis coming up. Any of you who shared those heart emojis want to share?
Well, I was in tears too, because my best friend and I and our group of friends went through maybe similar experiences, except I was just amazed and so grateful for your openness and love, because in our situation, it was a little bit different, where our church was so adamant. And, you know, now, of course, we've all made this journey. But so I was just in tears and my heart broken again for what my dear friend's now son, he's a transgender man, and he is so happy now in his life. And anyway, so it just broke my heart again for all those, so many of us, our friends who are suffering.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing of your love and acceptance. And I'm so glad that that relationship was still there.
Yes, me too. Thank you.
Thank you, Margie. I see Michael's hand.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Stacy. One of the things that you said that just enlivened me again is that, and all of us here have been on this path of deconstruction, of struggling with the narrowness of our former faith. And
yeah.
What I loved in your story was, and it just helped me realize it within my own story, but is how, as you just had to reject the old narrowness, God revealed to you the new lovingness, the love that's so full in this new manifestation of our love of what Jesus did for all of us, and how Jesus loved us all. We're marginalized, but not in the love of Jesus. Thanks, Stacy.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Michael. How about Lisa?
I just wanted to thank you for sharing not only your gift of song, but your heart. It's an honor to hear your story. It just reminds me of that whole idea of perfect love casting out fear, and how all fear is caused by you not being sure if somebody's going to accept you, and how simple a thing that is for me to accept people. And to also be accepted by them. And so it's like our responsibility is not to worry about people not accepting us. Our responsibility is to be real and to accept others. And I thought that is the epitome of fearlessness, and that's the epitome of love. And so thank you so much for sharing your story. I didn't know it. It's marvelous. And I'm cheering with you about your story. It was beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. And how much love you opened up for other families, right, who were struggling with the same thing. That's what amazes me too, is if you hadn't been open to that bigness of God, then you couldn't have written that letter that went viral, that then touched all these people, and then their families were changed because of it. Ernie?
Hi, Stacy. Thank you.
Hi.
I don't have anybody close that I'm aware of in my family, like younger or anything, that is maybe gay, but I do have a couple of friends whose teenagers are going through that.
Yeah.
And listening to you today is very warming, because I know these two friends of mine, I'm very close to them. And both are still married. Both, you know, the parents are married, And I know in one family, the dad was able to accept his daughter's wish, and it took the mom a little longer, but they're both on board. But I'm always wanting to, I listen easily, but also be that support. One of the kids was coming and staying with me while she was going through her transition. And she hadn't said anything to me, but her parents had. So while she was staying with me part of one summer, I told her her parents had shared with me, and to feel very free if she wanted to or needed to. I didn't ask her really any specific questions, but I wanted her to know I was there as a support.
Yeah.
And most of the time, it hasn't been the entire families and the kids, but I always like to share things with parents, even like your book, even though they're on that track, just more things, because we all have things.
Yes.
And hold things. So I appreciate your sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Caroline?
Well, Ernie, I'm sure that teenager must be so grateful to have you. Yes. But I was wondering, Stacy, did any of your former congregants, do you think any of their hearts were cracked open a little, or anybody that in that church that you were in?
I do. I think there were probably, I could count them on one hand, the people that have stayed in touch and have remained our friends, and, you know, have made it a point to reach out at various times and say to us, we're with you, we see you, and we are walking with you, and we're watching you do this. And we appreciate it, because any of our kids could come out, and we don't know. And we thank you for being vocal. It's the rarity that happens. And you know, I go back and forth between feeling you know, understanding for my former evangelical Christian friends, congregants, and feeling just wildly impatient and frustrated with them, you know, because I thought, you know, but what I have to understand is that, you know, and I say this with a great deal of humility and even a degree of shame at times, is that, you know, it took my own child coming out to really break my heart open to the point of this really radical shift in my thinking. And you know, someone asked me last service, do you think if your child had not come out, would you have made the same shift? Would you have opened your heart in the same way? And I don't know that I could ever answer that question fully to know. I do know what it feels like to be on the other side of that equation, and to have not fully opened my heart to it yet. And all I can do is continue to speak to sort of that middle space, you know, and hope that people see us living our lives and see us living our story, and will at some point come along. It's interesting, the ones that do call or send me a private text are the ones whose kids come out unexpectedly. You know, I heard from a music pastor in the Midwest about a month ago, and he was one who really shut his doors and he used to have me come and sing all the time at his church. After I began speaking about my book, and you know, the doors shut, he never invited me again, he didn't return my emails, nothing. But he called me out of the blue, and he was sobbing and said, my daughter last night came out to my wife and I, and you are the first person I thought to call. I can't trust any, I don't know, I can't talk to anybody on my own staff. I can't talk to any of my friends. He's at a big mega church, and his daughter came out. And I think this is happening. I mean, it's happening everywhere. We have people sitting next to us in choir, at Bible study, on the pews next to us, who are touched by this topic in one way or another. I just think we're not talking about it enough. or we're having the wrong conversations, you know? And that's why I wrote the book, first of all, I think we need to be more informed about the process by which a person can move from this very narrow way of thinking to a broader way. For me, it wasn't an easy shift. For some people, it might've been, but I think it takes a lot of untangling of your roots, you know, to get free of those old ways of thinking about this. But I've gone way off the topic, I think, now to your question.
No, that was all good. And I see Don has his hand up.
Yes, I just want to say it was great of you to be able to accept, because you have some parents that are out there that can accept.
Yeah.
That, and I believe a lot has to do with fear.
Yeah.
Fear of the unknown, fear of change, fear of, you know, acceptance and stuff like that. And I can understand that too, because it was like, you know, when I was working, you know, there were several great people in our office, and you would have some people that would treat them different and talk to them different, but they would come to me, because when I was a shop steward there at the time, they'd come to me over the other shop steward, because they said they felt more comfortable with me because I would treat them like I treat everybody else. And I mm-hmm. said, that's, you know, to me, you don't have to treat people different. Just treat them the same. And you have people that are in fear of that, because they fear even talking to some gay people, because they just like, oh, I don't want nobody to think I'm gay. And so they're in fear of that. I was like, you know, if you're a strong enough person mentally, you know, you are. You could just treat them like you treat everybody else. And I try to explain that to several people I worked with. But you know, just it's mainly fear.
Yeah.
And I think that that's what some parents have, is fear. And if they could get over that, you know, and they just accept them for who they are, it would make their child life a lot better.
I think you're right on. So much of my stuff was rooted in fear, you know, whether it was fear of the unknown. I don't know what this looks like. I don't know what it looks like for her to be with a woman happily ever after. I thought a man was supposed to take care of her. You know, I didn't know what it would look like for her to be in connection and relationship with God, as well as be an out lesbian woman. And it was just walking through, like I said, making room for the questions, making room for conversations. Like you said, just having a simple conversation with someone, it can let down so many walls, you know, of those fears. And I don't know. That's exactly right. And I wish I could, I wish there was a magic word I could help other parents with, to say, don't be afraid. It's going to be okay. You know, your kid's going to be just fine. But it's a real thing. Yeah.
I see Pastor Moore has his hand, and then Scott.
I wanted to ask a question. Oops. Yeah, I wanted to ask a question as it pertains to you being a creative. As we know, there's some amazing, wonderful music and other artistry that comes out of the evangelical church. And yet some of those songs that are so beautiful are also triggers, because it came from a place that we at one time were willing to accept and endorse, but sometimes not so much now. And yeah. I was just wondering if you think that you could have written a song like the one that we listened to at the start of our time together today. you know, it's a very expansive song and, you know, far reaching. And I was wondering if you think you could have written something like that before you became conscious.
Oh, that's a great question. It's, and I love the word you said, triggering. It's very difficult for me to walk into an evangelical church space and listen to worship music. It doesn't ring true anymore. Much of it doesn't. I forget who it was that said, but isn't there some kind of philosophy that says the older we get, the less we know, you know, just kind of like, I mean, if we're doing it right, you know what I mean? We become less certain. And I think for sure, so much of evangelical faith is about certainty, and so much of real life, I think, is about letting go of the need for control and certainty. And so to your question, I think I'm much more interested in pursuing mystery now as an artist than pursuing certainty, you know?
Nice.
Yeah.
Thank you. Scott?
Yeah, so I had the experience, I had a lesbian sister who died in the 90s. But I got to see my very conservative Irish mother, the terms with her when my sister came out in the late 70s and early 80s. It was a great lesson in parenting. My mother just became her biggest support in the end as she struggled with depression. My sister. But, you know, it made me think a lot. I remember a book by Jim Wallace, I don't remember the title. And, you know, I've often thought, well, where did this emphasis on sex come from in the first place? It's like it's the all end all and be all of morality that's in so many circles. And if it were up to me, I would decanonize St. Augustine, actually, as an Irish Catholic. But I think that's one of the sources. But this book in Jim Wallace, he was talking about, he did an exercise and he took a Bible, I don't know which translation, and they went first. One copy of the Bible, and they cut out all the words, anything that was about sex, Bible. It was hardly touched by the time they got done. Then they went and took a Bible and cut out all the words about justice. And it was like, Bible was ripped apart.
Wow.
You know, and the other thing I think about too is, we know utterly nothing about the sexuality of Jesus. You know, and it's just, I mean, we really know nothing about it, except that all indications are he didn't marry, which is a big deal for a Jewish male and his culture and stuff. So I just think it's so tragic that we've, in so many Christian circles, including the Catholic ones on the Catholic Church, is that this emphasis has got, you know, we've inherited in too many ways. You know, it's been on us. The box that Stacey, you felt you were putting God into it. So many of us did when we were younger. Was a box that was just thrown at you, in a sense. But it was great to hear you talk to us.
Thank you.
Reminded me of my mother's love. My sister.
Thank you.
All right. Well, if everyone's gotten a chance to share, I just want to thank you all so much for the discussion.
Yes, me too. And we're going to have communion in just a moment. And let me just say, you mentioned Torn by Justin Lee, Stacy. And some years ago, I used to lead a different church. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people I dearly love, and yet we used to do you know, read books together, and so I put forth Justin's book Torn, and several people left the church, and some just left mentally and emotionally, but they were still physically present.
Wow.
And the fact is that most of the people who left didn't read the book. Just the fact that it was about his homosexual experience was enough for them to make conclusions about it. Mm-hmm. So it speaks to the, you know, what you're talking about, how enclosed the religious community can be. Mm-hmm. And again, I want to thank you for being so transparent and willing to open up and share your experience. We at Jesus Collective, we have had gay and transgender speakers before, but they didn't explore their journey, their experience. They just happened to be gay and transgender speakers, right, and they spoke on what was on their heart at that time. Mm-hmm. So this may be the first time we've had somebody take us through their personal journey. Mm. And so we're really grateful to host you today, and want to send you love. So let's have communion, fam. We turn our hearts to the one. The one who is, just like I said earlier, I said, we are Stacy and Stacy is us. Well, this is certainly true of the one. He is us. We are him. We are transformed and we are transforming. And the course that Jesus took eventuated in his execution, being put down by the state. Because just because you're doing the right thing doesn't mean it's going to be acceptable by decision makers. Mm-hmm. And so it can cost you. It can, you know, I mentioned before how, you know, I not just lost parishioners, but I lost basically a relationship with a denomination, you know, facing their disapproval. But you know what? I'd do it all over again. And so would you, of course.
Yes.
But Jesus took this course that cost him, showing us, giving us the courage, imparting to us a vision that we can just, if we know we're doing what needs to be done, if we know we're behaving in love and compassion, we're on the right path. The body and the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, would you eat and drink? Mm-hmm.